Like, take a second to introduce myself. My name is Mark McLean. This is Salvatore Orlando.
Hi, guys.
We are both core team members for the Neutron team and have been involved with the project for probably way too long. So what we're going to do is we're going to go through and kind of give you an overview and kind of take a tour through Neutron, what it is, how it's made up, take a look at what the reference architecture looks like. And so fundamentally, when we first started taking a look at why did we want to create Neutron, we had several things we needed to solve. And one of those things, we needed the ability to create rich topologies. We needed the ability to be technology agnostic. You don't want to be locked into a particular vendor, especially as technology changes over time or as you change and build out data centers differently or maybe stand up new data centers, you want to have the opportunity to re-examine your technology choices, as well as make sure it's extensible. One of the challenges when making any kind of service is that if you want it to be backed by multiple vendors, how do you expose all the different features? And the short answer is you can't unless you have the ability to extend it. And then lastly, how do we provide advanced services support? So some examples of those would be like load balancing, VPN, firewall. And then we're trying to balance those, whether you're taking a look at some of the challenges in the cloud of how you do high density multi-tenancy. VLANs have trouble scaling. You have a limited number of VLANs. So, if you have 5,000 tenants, VLANs aren't necessarily going to be your solution. Also, the ability to do on-demand provisioning, that you want to be able to move and migrate workloads around the data center, as well as maybe you have legacy applications which are tied to static IPs. So when tackling those challenges, we need to provide different solutions, whether it's network virtualization. We can do overlay tunneling with VXLAN, SDT, GRE, as well as use other SDN constructs like OpenFlow, L2 Fabric solution, or even question marks. Always include this because you never quite know what the next thing in networking is going to be. And so we need to have that ability to leverage it. So the basics of Neutron, what we're taking a look at is primarily, if you were to, say, have your typical user and the fonts again. So we have our typical user where you have like the compute API, the networking API, and the storage API. It's traditionally the user is going to see the same API regardless of whether your backend's KVM, the ML2 plugin, or maybe it's a proprietary plugin or some other storage technology. And so that's what, when we created Neutron, we're going to provide that same similar generic API that you would find, say, in Nova, that you would find in Sender. And so with that, we created several basic abstractions. Neutron really fundamentally has a very small core of you're going to have a L2 virtual network, which is a shared broadcast domain, a layer 3 subnet, and then you have a virtual port, which is basically like a port on the switch, which you connect into the VIF on the VM. So using the API and these really basic constructs, you can create richer topologies. In this case, it's a tenant's created two different isolated segments. So our design goal was we wanted to have, like I said earlier, a unified API, a small core. Mainly, we kept the core small so that all implementers and it would cover the broadest range of offerings from the different vendors. A pluggable open architecture, so that way you can plug in different vendor implementations, and deployers have a choice of which vendors they use, whether they use a proprietary open source, and also extensible, so they have the opportunity to gain access to new features. So when we did that, some of the common features we baked in support for overlapping IPs. In traditional data center, if you have overlapping IPs, you have problems in terms of routing. You have to set up special routing rules. But a use case where you'd want overlapping IPs is maybe you're doing CI/CD pipelines. You want to have the ability to stand up the application in the exact environment. With this, you can have two tenants can have the exact same address space. As well as you have the ability for configuration and metadata with DHCP, is typical what you'll find. Also, enable support for config drive via the integration with Nova. And so that you have, those are the common features you'll find across the different plugins. As well as the ability to have floating IPs. So if you have RFC 1918 space, you want to expose different VMs to the public internet, you have the ability to provide NATed floated traffic, as well as provide support for security groups, whether it's support for over, and one of the differences between the Neutron implementation of security groups and the Nova, original Nova network one, is provided support for overlapping IPs, also provides the ability to create security group rules for ingress and egress of traffic, as well as IPv6 support and support VMs with multiple VIFs so that you can have the ability to apply different security group policies to the VIFs. So, Sav, do you want to dive into architecture?
Yeah. So, thanks, Mark, for this introduction. Now, it's up to me to talk about apparently common features, design goals, and using the API. When are we supposed to have different slides?
Green button.
And it's up to me to talk about the architecture. And as you can see, this is the operator view of the OpenStack architecture. As you can see, it's very simple and not confusing at all. Anyway, Neutron is that... This is going backwards.
Green.
Neutron is that little bit on the right side. Still, if we look at it from the high-level perspective, it's relatively simple. Still, we really wanted to make things difficult for you by using such a small font. So, since I don't think anybody can actually read anything in there, what is Neutron? Neutron is just a set of colorful boxes. That's it. So,
you want me to fix that real quick?
And that's pretty much a really accurate description. The only problem is that they are not even colored. It's just black and white. But you, all right. Now, so on Neutron, still at a high, at least from a high level perspective, it's a relatively simple system because on one side you have a Neutron server, which is a REST API server, which is a receives API calls directly from tenants or other applications, but also uses the REST API endpoint to communicate with other projects such as Nova. It has a database, an internal database. And then on the other end, there are the agents which do the data plan slash control plane operations. So there are layer two agents, which are relatively simple. They pretty much just do create the broadcast domains. L3 agents, which take care of router forwarding and nothing features. Then DHCP agent, obviously, is quite self-explicative. And then we have several possibility of binding Neutron to several advanced services, namely load balancing, VPN, and firewall. And all these things are connected through a message queue. Then, the server runs a plugin. A plugin can be monolithic, and monolithic plugins are mostly two kinds. Either it's either a proxy towards a third-party system, like, for instance, you know, OpenContrail on either VMware NSX, if you want, and then all can be a direct control, like the plugin implements the management and the control plane for your network solution, for your network virtualization solution. If you don't want to use a monolithic plugin, there is also the option of using the ML2 plugin called or modular layer 2 plugin, which is still a full plugin implementation. So from the outside, let's say it could be considered as a monolithic full control plugin, but inside it can run several drivers that allow you to plug different technologies. And this could be either type manager driver or mechanism manager driver. The former are for managing, let's say, transport types like VXLAN or VLAN, GRE, or whatever you want. And the other are for attaching mechanism, which could be, let's say, physical controlling physical switches or controlling virtual switches. For instance, you know, the OVS Open vSwitch is a mechanism driver, and there are mechanism drivers for a lot of, let's say, third-party solutions. And basically, this is just, if you want, an implementation of a strategy pattern that allows us to be very flexible and modular. The ML2 plugin can be also extended. I mean, extensions apply not just to ML2 plugin, but to all plugins. This allows us to extend the API in several ways, either adding completely new resources to the API endpoints or extending the features and capability of existing API resources. So you can have you can list all the extensions that are available querying that endpoint. We don't have a laser pointer here, but the endpoint is v2/extensions. And there are two types of extensions if you want. One are common extensions that, like, you know, extensions for doing layer 3, provider networks, for managing quotas or security groups. Some of these, I would say, are so common that are probably not even extensions. So they de facto, they are part of the core API. And then the other extensions, which are little bit less used with allowed address pairs, extra routes. Some extensions are even a little bit more particular because they are served by the so-called service plugins. And this means that these extensions, like metering, are actually not routed to the main plugin, but they're routed to another plugin, which is called a service plugin, which extends the capabilities provided by the Neutron plugin that we just seen in the previous slide. And then this is probably the picture that gives the title to the presentation, I guess, Mark.
Yes.
So it's bridges and tunnels. And I mean, apparently, Mark went to a trip to Budapest and fell in love with Budapest. So he took these pictures. And one is a bridge. The other is a roundabout, and then there is the tunnel. Mark explained the thing to me a little bit, and basically you get into a tunnel, and then you have a roundabout that dispatches traffic, and then you first get into a bridge, then a roundabout that dispatches traffic, and then you end up in a tunnel, which is pretty much what happens to Neutron. The only thing that the traffic is not orderly at all. And so what are the components that allow us to do so? First, there is the layer 2 agents. The task of the layer 2 agents is very simple. It's just to creating an isolated broadcast domain. It runs on the hypervisor, and it communicates, obviously, with the server through the message bus, as we've seen before. And basically, it's just there, sitting there, and watching when new devices appear on the bridge. And a new device pops up on OpenBSwitch and say, oh, here you are a device. Do you belong to this particular VM? I'm going to wire you to go into the network for that particular VM. And it's pretty much it. It's very simple. And the only thing that it has to do, the layer of AS agent, is being extremely scalable and fast and secure. Yeah. Also, it has to be secure, and that's why it does not just wire the interface, but it also applies security groups rules and anti-spoofing rules to make sure, you know, that in theory nobody should be able to sniff your traffic. Right. So this is an example for the OVS layer 2 agent, where you have the server, the agent, and OVS itself, which is not yet in the picture, but I swear it will appear soon. So the Neutron server communicates over the message bus with the agent, for instance, for notifying of a new security group update. And the agent then talks to OVS using the OVS DB interface and programs it accordingly. So actually, there is also another thing in the picture, which is IP tables, perhaps. So when you have, for instance, a security group update, where the agent doesn't talk to OVS for programming OVS DB, but in most, it configures IP tables. Then we have isolation. We have different kinds of isolations which are supported. You can do VLANs, but as you can say, as you know, VLANs have several limitations. And when people usually mention that the limitation of VLAN is the 4K number, actually that's not the real limitation. The real limitation of VLAN is that the underlay and all the bits that you come of the underlay must support contiguous VLAN segments. And that's not always possible. Then you have other solutions, like, which are based on tunneling, which are my preferred solutions. I know that most people don't think they're good solutions, but I prefer them. And you can do either GRE or VXLAN, where layer 2 is encapsulated in a higher level protocol. In the case of GRE, for instance, L2 is encapsulated in an L3 IP fragment. And it's routable. And you get the overlay is independent for the underlay, because everything that the underlay has just to provide IP connectivity, nothing else. So as long as you can reach the other endpoint through its IP, so as long as its IP is routable, you're fine. You can establish a tunnel. And yeah, we're talking about tunneling. So here we have four, these are like four hosts, and we are going to show how this tunneling works. So here you have a VM A that wants to communicate with VMD, and so it sends a broadcast message across all tunnels to find where the receiver is. So as you can see, BC, there's no connection in BC to the tunnel because they had a fight a few years ago and they've not talked to each other since then. But the problem here is that when you go to large networks, you get like a lot of broadcasts sent over the various tunnels, which is probably not ideal. Imagine if you have not four, but 1,000 hosts there. So for this reason, the OpenStack agent implements a mechanism which is called L2 population. L2 population allows us to know exactly where the destination host is sitting. In this case, so host A knows where the destination VM, this one, this little red dot here, is sitting. And so it will send the message only on the appropriate tunnel. And I mean, here it will be like one, just one channel employed rather than three tunnels. But in this case, it's not a lot of gain. But just imagine if you had like 100 hosts here instead of just four hosts. So the last bit is I'll talk about you, are the L3 agents. The L3 agents don't run on the hypervisor. They run on the dedicated network node. And their task is obviously all that forwarding traffic at layer 3. They do traffic forwarding for east-west and traffic forwarding for north-south traffic. They use IP namespaces. They use IP namespaces, and they have, if you enable it, they allow communication with the Nova metadata server through the metadata agent, if you enable them. So this remote is not working anymore. So it's implemented, as we said, using IP namespaces. And the concept of IP namespaces is fairly simple. So you have the main host, let's say the main namespace, which is the host namespace, which is hosting the integration bridge, the OpenVSwitch integration bridge. And the various isolated namespaces, where you have, let's say, a different namespace for each different neutron virtual router, are then all connected to this integration bridge. But they all have the same full networking stack. So you have each namespace has different network interfaces, has different IP tables, different route tables, and they don't interfere each other. So for instance, you can achieve, this is what allows you to achieve overlapping IPs, for instance, because you can have the same IP address configured multiple times in different IP namespaces. And then these namespaces are bridged to the main integration bridge to provide connectivity to outside the host. So basically, this is very high level, how the L3 agent is implemented. And yeah. And then we move to advanced services. I'm sorry, we don't have time in this talk to talk about all the advanced services that we have. We just mentioned a bit the load balancer service because it's undergoing like major refurbishment. And the load balancing service is one of those service plugins that I previously mentioned. So at the management layer is a service plugin. And then at the control plane layer is implemented with an agent and a driver. The agent communicates over RPC with the driver, which is running as a part of the plugin. And you can have, I think in the Neutron Source 3, you have an implementation which is entirely based on HA proxy. But you can also leverage several third-party drivers which are available as remote systems that the load balancing plugin can configure. So this is, I hope that I managed to do my job of confusing you and giving you a bad headache. So I think it's all for me, and I'll hand it over to Mark to finish giving you that by PowerPoint.
Yep. So we want to take a look at what's new in Juno. So one of the biggest changes in Juno is we've finished our work in enabling IPv6 support. It is the future. It's here. So we have a couple basics. What we've added is we've added router advertisement support into the network nodes. We've also supplied with a couple different algorithms. We've called them either Slack or the default algorithm, as some people refer to as sequential. Essentially, it's the same algorithm that you would find in our V4. IPAM today, which is just keeps assigning the lowest number till a pool exhausts, it compacts the pool and recycles. As well as one of the things when you're doing an IPv6 network, you want to make sure that you secure RA announcements, because the last thing you want is for a VM to come up and start hijacking all your traffic. So when we take a look at some of the different ways we do it, with IPv6 Slack, basically this configuration is where you enable RA auto configuration, you have a delegated prefix for the tenant's network, and the IP address is generated using EUI64, or basically on the MAC address. It's a well-known algorithm for generating the addresses. Nice thing about this is that as you generate MAC addresses for your VMs or even hardware in the cloud, the addresses are, you don't have to go through the in terms of detecting for collisions, because the IPv6 protocol will do it for you. We don't run DHCP in this situation. In some cases, though, Slack doesn't give you the ability to pass enough options to the host. So some people want to refer to what we call, which we refer to as DHCPv6 stateless. In this case, you have essentially the same configuration as you did before with Slack, but you have the ability to we stand up a DHCPv6 server, and you can pass the options which are not available via the router advertisement. And then the last mode is you can actually run DHCPv6 stateful. It's basically very similar to how we do IPv4 today. It's full DHCP services. You can configure options for those. And so as the VMs boot, it can request any of the options as needed. In this case, we use RADVD on the router, and we use DNS mask to provide DHCP services. One of the things that comes up is, should I run IPv6 if I'm building out a new data center? Should I run it today in a dual stack or a single stack? So if you're standing up a greenfield deployment, which you know you're going full v6, for dual stack, the nice thing about that is your applications have the ability to address both v4 and v6. This will be supported by the latest long-term support releases of most all the operating systems. When you do single stack v6, it gets a little bit more interesting, because one of the problems you have is that if your application requires that the OpenStack metadata service works, Cloud Init only makes v4 requests to the metadata service. So one of those things is, in order to work around that, you have to have config drive enabled in your deployment. Generally, config drive will give you more stability, but the reason I put the star beside it is you have to have an operating system image that's configured to use config drive. If you have a Cloud Init-based operating system image, this will work. But if you're using a different operating system not based on Cloud Init, you have to write the scripts necessary to read the config drive information. Another big change we made is into distributed virtual routing. So as Salvatore talked a little bit before, we have our typical architecture where you see the core, you have a network node, you have VMs and hypervisors. All the L3 services are on a network node or a collection of network nodes. We use namespaces. But what happens if you have a really noisy hypervisor? So our hypervisor starts generating lots of traffic. Eventually, we could saturate our network node to the point that we've now saturated our core link. And so now all of our traffic and data center is not only going through a single point of failure, but we've also saturated the link. What if we had an option to actually route directly from that hypervisor into our core without having to go through the network node, without having to process the NAT traffic in the network node and do it directly on the hypervisor? Essentially, this is how DVR works. So when we take a look at it, typically a three-step process if you're a deployer for rolling out DVR is you want to install it. You're going to enable an agent that runs on each hypervisor. So we're now running both an L2 agent and a DVR L3 agent on each hypervisor. You're going to associate a floating IP with the address, profit, right? Actually, really, in reality, you're going to get all north-south traffic is going to be NATed directly from the hypervisor and skip the network node. So going back to it, so that fixes north-south traffic, but what about east-west traffic? So if we have two instances running and it wants to talk, the east-west will typically traverse the network node. When you have DVR enabled, we can actually talk directly hypervisor to hypervisor because we can directly tunnel using L2 population. With north-south, if you don't have a floating IP, so the key component for getting full north-south bandwidth is having a floating IP. So if you don't have a floating IP, it's going to go out through the network node. If you do have a floating IP, it's going to go around the network node. One of the other improvements we have is we've improved security groups tremendously in Juno. Sal and I were talking over lunch, and that the efficiencies of implementation have made in terms of security groups have actually made it easier to boot. One of the things we changed is we started using IP sets. So kind of like if you look at Ponte Muse, where you have lots of locks on it. If you know they put so many locks on the bridge, panels started falling off. Same thing with IP tables. If you put too many rules in there, IP tables becomes very slow and starts breaking down in some cases. So with IP sets, we can actually speed up their ability to process security group rules by aggregating. Last thing is we provided L3 HA. So now when you have a network node, we can actually run them in pairs. Using connection tracking, we can share state. And so if a network node were to die, the other network node would take over and basically seamlessly transition your traffic. and kind of opening up and looking on the horizon for looking ahead into Kilo, some of the things the team's going to be working on over the next cycle is paying down our technical debt. Neutron being a project, it's been around three and a half years, right?
Yeah, three and a half.
So 3.5 years. And so as we've grown, we made some choices that over the time that were good at the time, but as we've grown the project and as we've learned, it's time to go through and revisit some of those choices. So we're going to pay down some of that debt. We're going to take a look at some of the initial choices we made. We're also going to continue work on IPv6. One of the abilities we need is the ability to prefix delegation. So if you have a large public address block, what you don't want is you don't want tenants self-selecting what their prefix they're going to use for their network. So make that configurable by the deployer, as well as improve our IPAM service. Our IPAM service was something we initially made very simple, always said we'd come back and revisit, and now we're coming back to finally revisit it. Another one is facilitate dynamic routing. As Salvatore said, Neutron does very static routing. What we want to have the ability to do is to speak BGP so that within the data center fabric, you can express the routes that are available and the locations within your deployment, as well as enabling NFV applications. The NFV subteam, which is kind of cuts across several disciplines and several projects within the OpenStack community, we have to go through and make a few enhancements to make their job easier. So in summary, Neutron really is about a small unified API, has a small core. Essentially, we have three main resources. We have several extended resources, as Salvatore said, and many of them are common that you find in almost every implementation. Pluggable open architecture that has multi-vendor support. So if you take a look, you'll see many well-known names on this slide. And it's extensible, so that as a vendor or as the open source community dreams up a new feature, we have the ability to export that and make that available to deployers who choose to deploy it. And then lastly, for more information, the Cloud Administrator Guide's available, as well as the V2 API. So with that, thanks for listening. Does anybody have any questions for us?
There are mics over there. Nova has availability zones, and Neutron have no idea about them. When instance start, its router go to random random network node, and there is no way to group compute and networking to single availability zone. I saw something about agent scheduling in new versions. But will that scheduling support for some kind of separation of faults in OpenStack? Thanks.
Currently, right now, it's come up only briefly, but as far as real community drive for implementing availability zones in Neutron, that's not something that's bubbled up too high. I do agree with the point that you want to have the ability to at least ensure that your network node and your VMs are spread out. One of the things that you could possibly do is at least with network nodes and high availability, you can, and this would be future work on the high availability schedulers, the ability to put the instances of the network nodes into different availability zones that you would have increase your uptime. But mainly, I don't anticipate we'll get to that in Kilo. That's probably an L, M, N kind of thing.
But there is no way to say where the pair of Neutron nodes with DVR going to be.
So when you're with DVR, the actual L3 routing, if you have a floating IP, it actually occurs directly on the hypervisor, and it's routed directly from the hypervisor into your core. If you're doing just normal source NAT traffic, it's going to go through the node pair. And right now, they're just assigned based on a space available basis without any kind of recognition of where the VMs are ensuring that the pairs are in different AZs right now, mainly because Neutron is just not AZ aware.
OK, thank you. Sure.
What's the timeline for IPv6 translation, private to global address or local to global address? Post-K as well?
So actually doing IPv6 NAT?
Yeah.
Yes. Okay. Fundamentally, most of the folks who have been working in IPv6 team, all their use cases were actually publicly routable IPv6 addresses. I do recognize that some folks like the ability to renumber networks. If you're doing prefix delegation with Slack, it makes that pain a lot less. But as far as doing v6 NAT, at least L, possibly K. Mainly, we have to have developers who want to do it. Yep.
I had a couple of questions. You said when we have DVR, the traffic is bridged directly from hypervisor to the core. So if I'm running a firewall in the network node, how does it work?
So if you have an edge-based firewall, how does it work? So the firewall as a service is an experimental service available in Neutron. It's an API which we exported. The DVR team worked to ensure that the edge firewall rules were actually pushed down into the hypervisor, into the L3 routing namespace. So effectively, you get the same logical edge firewall that you're getting. It's just that the rules are applied much closer to the VM. So yeah, there is a presentation later on today that actually dives even deeper into DVR. So, right after. All right.
And sorry, I have one more. Mm-hmm. So there's only currently there's only edge-based firewall. Is there a plan to have if I have a three-tier architecture, web tier, app tier, and DB, is there a plan where I can insert different firewalls at layers into Neutron?
So the question is there a plan to do service insertion of firewalls,
right,
essentially? That topic has come up frequently. Mainly, initially, we started with an edge-based firewall to prove out the API and to harden implementation. And so until we get the edge-based firewall done, I don't anticipate the team's going to move on to the ability to insert firewalls. In the interim, though, you do have the ability to apply security groups onto any port, which gives you which covers some of that use case, but not completely all of it. I know some folks want to be able to apply firewalls between networks and whatnot. Yep.
Thanks.
Any others? All right.
More questions?
Thank you all for your time.
Thank you, guys.